Imagine entering a specific area in a museum and finding a skeletal reconstruction of a Neanderthal, like La Ferrassie 1, one of the most complete Neanderthal skeletons ever discovered. Found in 1909 at the La Ferrassie site in France, this fossil includes a well-preserved skull, pelvis, limbs, and is estimated to be around 70,000 years old. You would probably think that his physical attributes closely resemble that of some early humans. Well, archaeologists have come across surprising evidence showing that it was possible for Neanderthals and Homo sapiens to have had children. This astonishing discovery changes all the available evidence we have concerning the two human groups, thus arousing a lot of interest concerning how they relate to each other. This new information is exciting, yet disturbing, because it's a branch of the evolution of humankind that still holds many mysteries. In this video, we will analyze various theories surrounding the extinction of our cousins, the Neanderthals. What new evidence supports the reasons for their demise? Was it climate change, competition with Homo sapiens, the rise of contagious diseases, or even war? Let's begin our investigation. Neanderthals inhabited Europe for an astonishing period, their presence dating back approximately 400,000 years. This conclusion is supported by a wealth of archaeological evidence, including the discovery of numerous fossils and artifacts across the continent. The first one, named Gibraltar 1, is one of the earliest Neanderthal skulls found in Gibraltar in the year 1848. Then in a place called Cima de los Huesos, a site in northern Spain, over 6,500 Neanderthal fossils have been found, which are helping put together their physical characteristics and population dynamics. We also have the Swanscombe skull, which is a partial skull found in England, proving their presence in Europe around 400,000 years ago. Even Neanderthal child remains discovered in Gibraltar at a place called the Devil's Tower provide additional evidence of their long-term habitation in the region. But Neanderthals were not confined to a specific region within Europe. They did very well all over the continent, inhabiting a vast area ranging from Portugal and Wales in the west to the Altai Mountains of Siberia in the east, and establishing their presence in northern Belgium, the Mediterranean, and Southwest Asia, located to the south of Europe. These adaptable hominids were well suited for the harsh conditions of Ice Age Europe, highlighting their adaptability to diverse environments. They were completely entwined with the continent's geography, leaving a heavy archaeological imprint from the tremendous cliffs of Gibraltar to the secret caves of France and Spain. Tools they used can be found there as well as some famous paintings. A fascinating discovery is La Roche-Cotard cave in France, sealed for over 57,000 years. This cave revealed ancient engravings that have been attributed to Neanderthals. These engravings predate the arrival of Homo sapiens in the region and show off Neanderthals' artistic ability and use of symbolic thought. Their tools and artifacts have been found in numerous European sites. These include stone tools, such as Mousterian tools, known for their sophisticated craftsmanship, which are a hallmark of Neanderthal technology. Evidence of hunting tools, such as spears and flint hand axes, suggest Neanderthals were skilled hunters. As far as personal effects, Neanderthals also left behind jewelry and possibly musical instruments. This heritage is priceless since it demonstrates how they lived, their culture, and more importantly, when they disappeared completely from Europe. So if you're ever gazing over European landscapes, don't forget that this place was once traveled by these ancient dwellers. Now, let's turn our attention to the arrival of another human species that Neanderthals coexisted with for a very long time, Homo sapiens, on the European stage. Paul Salopek, an award-winning journalist and National Geographic explorer, embarked on an extraordinary journey, retracing the footsteps of our ancestors as they migrated out of Africa. His Out of Eden walk aims to document the places, people, and stories along this ancient route. Salopek's journey began in Hertobori, Ethiopia, a site renowned for its 160,000-year-old heteroman fossil, one of the oldest known modern human remains. This location serves as a symbolic starting point for retracing the migration route of early humans out of Africa. While the exact timing of this initial migration wave is debated, there's growing evidence that some modern humans left Africa as early as 125,000 years ago. This earlier migration may have occurred through the Nile Valley, Sinai Peninsula, and Levant. The most significant migration wave out of Africa is believed to have occurred around 70,000 to 50,000 years ago. A small group of modern humans, possibly numbering fewer than 1,000 individuals, crossed the Red Sea at Bab el Mandeb and spread along the coastal route through Arabia and Persia to South Asia. From South Asia, modern humans continued their migration, reaching Southeast Asia and Oceania around 65,000 to 50,000 years ago, gradually spreading across Eurasia and marking the beginning of a period of coexistence with Neanderthals. Two distinct human species sharing the same continent. Now, there are also several archaeological sites that provide early modern human presence outside of Africa, such as the Jebel Fayyah in the UAE, which contains stone tools dating back to around 125,000 years ago, proving the claims of the Arabian Peninsula being used as the route through which they migrated. If you like learning about the mysterious lives of Neanderthals and early Homo sapiens, why not subscribe for more primitive history content? In present Europe, sites in Italy, Spain, and France have yielded artifacts and remains from both groups, suggesting that they inhabited overlapping regions and interacted for a period of time. During this time, Europe was experiencing a dynamic climate. The Ice Age was in full swing, with periods of glacial advance and retreat. This fluctuating climate would have presented challenges for both species, requiring them to adapt to changing conditions. Were these two ancient human species primarily rivals, or did they coexist peacefully? Like we said, Neanderthals and Homo sapiens coexisted for thousands of years, sharing the same landscapes and resources. The prevailing narrative has long been one of competition. However, recent research suggests a more nuanced relationship. Archaeological evidence from sites in Europe and Asia support this coexistence, with artifacts and remains from both groups from close proximity. A compelling example comes from the recent excavations at the Ranis site in Germany. The Ranis site, previously known for its intricate leaf-shaped stone tools, has yielded some amazing evidence concerning their coexistence in Northern Europe. Bone fragments unearthed from the site were subjected to detailed analysis, including DNA testing. The results were conclusive. The bones belonged to Homo sapiens, dating back to around 45,000 years ago. This discovery significantly overlaps with the known timeline of Neanderthals in the region, suggesting a period of coexistence lasting several millennia. As far as cultural exchange goes, while direct evidence is limited, the possibility cannot be ruled out. The recent discovery of stone tools in Saudi Arabia by the University of Oxford's Paleo Deserts project sheds light on this possibility. These tools bear a striking resemblance to artifacts typically associated with Neanderthals in the Levant region, suggesting that Neanderthals' toolmaking techniques may have been adopted by Homo sapiens during their interactions. This finding aligns with Dr. Hao S. Gruka's research focus, which emphasizes the importance of studying stone tool assemblages to understand the cultural exchange between the two species. The similarities in tools and behaviors suggest some level of shared knowledge or influence. While the evidence for direct conflict is scarce, competition for resources would certainly have played a role. Homo sapiens' larger populations and more efficient hunting strategies could have created pressure on Neanderthal communities. Early modern humans developed the skill of throwing spears, allowing them to hunt from safe distances and target more wary prey. Neanderthals primarily relied on thrusting spears, requiring closer proximity to their prey and potentially making them more vulnerable to attacks. Throwing spears likely allowed Homo sapiens to hunt more efficiently and obtain a greater quantity of food. Hunting from a distance reduced the risk of injury and death for Homo sapiens compared to Neanderthals' close-range approach. Hence, we can say that the interactions between Neanderthals and Homo sapiens were likely multifaceted. While competition may have played a role, coexistence, genetic exchange, and potential cultural exchange also likely occurred. Recent advancements in ancient DNA analysis have revolutionized our understanding of human evolution. One of the most groundbreaking discoveries has been the presence of Neanderthal DNA in modern humans. Studies have revealed that non-African populations carry approximately 1 to 4% of Neanderthal DNA, depending on their geographic origin. This indicates that interbreeding between the two species occurred during their coexistence. Researchers believe these genetic exchanges likely took place in Western Eurasia, where Neanderthals and Homo sapiens overlapped. Evidence suggests multiple waves of interbreeding between Neanderthals and Homo sapiens, with some occurring as early as 100,000 years ago, challenging previous estimates of modern human migration out of Africa. This means that the genetic mixture wasn't a one-time event. But because the Neanderthal DNA found in modern humans is not evenly distributed, some individuals carry more Neanderthal ancestry than others. It suggests that interbreeding events were not uniform. The presence of Neanderthal DNA in modern humans suggests an even more complex relationship than previously believed. Some researchers believe that Neanderthal DNA may have helped early modern humans adapt to the Eurasian environment. For example, genes related to skin pigmentation and immunity could have provided advantages in new climates. Key research and evidence that proved the presence of Neanderthal DNA in modern humans include a seminal study published in Science by Green and others in 2010. Then, in 2014, we had Pruffer and others, who sequenced the Vindiger Neanderthal genome, allowing for a more precise estimation of Neanderthal ancestry in modern humans. In 2015, Rossimo and others' research focused on identifying regions of the genome that show evidence of Neanderthal integration, analyzing the potential functional consequences of these integrated alleles. These are genes or genetic variants that have been transferred from one species or population to another through interbreeding, followed by repeated backcrossing with one of the parent populations. And a study by Gittleman and others in 2016 investigated the effects of Neanderthal integration variation on gene expression, proving insights into how Neanderthal DNA may have influenced modern human biology. Although their DNA constitutes only a small portion of the genetic material in modern humans, it has a subtle yet significant impact on various traits. Studies have identified associations between Neanderthal DNA and a range of physical and psychological characteristics. Their genetic presence can influence skin biology, including susceptibility to sun-induced skin lesions, as well as neurological and psychiatric conditions such as depression and nicotine addiction. Additionally, Neanderthal DNA may affect traits related to immunity, metabolism, and reproductive health. While both groups demonstrate remarkable adaptability against rigorous climate, subtle differences in their strategies likely played a role in their eventual fates. Both Neanderthals and Homo sapiens inhabited Europe during the Pleistocene epoch, a period marked by dramatic climate swings. Think of a landscape transformed by massive glaciers, vast ice sheets, and periods of intense cold. The fluctuating weather patterns were a challenging environment for both species. Glacial advances would have covered large portions of Europe in ice, creating harsh conditions with limited resources. Finding food and shelter during this period marked a challenge for both Neanderthals and Homo sapiens. However, when interglacial periods brought warmer temperatures and melting glaciers, newer areas for exploration and resource gathering opened up. But these periods were quite unpredictable, with rapid shifts in climate that could disrupt ecosystems and food sources. Because the Pleistocene epoch was a time of constant change, Neanderthals and Homo sapiens needed to adapt to survive in a continuously evolving landscape by adjusting their hunting strategies, gathering techniques, and shelter construction. Neanderthals demonstrated their ability and skill for hunting by focusing on large game, like mammoths and deer. They possessed advanced hunting techniques and tools suitable for colder climates. Some examples of cold climate hunting tools include heavy-duty spears. Neanderthals likely used longer, thicker spears to bring down large prey in the colder environment. For hunting aquatic animals, Neanderthals developed harpoons with barbed tops and longer handles suitable for throwing and penetrating thick hides. They were also adept at gathering plant resources and foraging for edible roots, berries, and nuts. So, if Neanderthals were able to adapt to different scenarios, why did early humans thrive instead? Homo sapiens had a few advantages. They secured a more varied diet, including smaller game, fish, and shellfish. This broader range of food sources gave them greater flexibility in adapting to the fluctuating environments. Their range of tools and techniques were also much wider and advanced in hunting weapons. Early humans possibly developed simple boats for fishing and better shelters for protection against harsh weather. Their innovation led them to create a special throwing device that increased the velocity and range of spears, This new technology, named a luttle, is believed to have been used since the Upper Paleolithic and allowed for hunting at a safe distance and target more wary prey. Other cool weapons included bows and arrows, which offered an even greater accuracy, range, and power compared to spears, and likely played a crucial role in Homo sapiens' expansion into new territories. And let's not forget the composite tools developed by early humans, combining materials like wood, bone, and stone to create more efficient and versatile weapons, which allowed for the creation of specialized hunting tools such as harpoons and fishhooks. Homo sapiens' social networks were likely more extensive and complex than those of Neanderthals, facilitating the trade of resources among larger groups, knowledge sharing of skills and practices across generations, and enhancing cooperation and innovation. All these factors potentially enabled more complex cultural practices, including rituals, ceremonies, and storytelling. The competitive edge between the two groups during these testing times was crucial. Homo sapiens' more diverse diet, advanced technologies, and larger, more complex social network gave them the competitive advantage needed to survive and prevail during times of scarcity. The extinction of Neanderthals remains a complex puzzle, but new research points to a potential culprit. A study, led by researchers at Stanford University, proposes that Neanderthals may have been particularly vulnerable to pathogens introduced by migrating early humans. This theory is supported by several key factors. Neanderthals and Homo sapiens evolved in separate regions, leading to distinct pathogen exposures. Homo sapiens, migrating out of Africa, carried a reservoir of tropical diseases to which Neanderthals, adapted to their Eurasian environment, lacked immunity for. These diseases could have been particularly devastating for Neanderthals, who may have had limited exposure to such pathogens, having evolved in a less diverse environment. Homo sapiens, having co-evolved with a wider range of pathogens in Africa, may have developed greater resistance to diseases. Mathematical models, presented in a 2019 study by Greenbaum and others, published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, demonstrated the potential role of diseases in the extinction of Neanderthals, highlighting how infectious diseases might have significantly contributed to their decline. The introduction of these new pathogens, including Helicobacter pylori, stomach ulcers, herpes simplex, genital herpes, and tuberculosis, likely had a significant impact on Neanderthal health. They had the potential to quickly weaken their immune system, making them more susceptible to other illnesses and reducing their overall fitness. Outbreaks of disease could have reduced and fragmented Neanderthal populations, limiting their ability to adapt and recover, therefore making them more vulnerable. Think of it in this way. Smaller, isolated populations with higher mortality rates due to weak immune systems are more vulnerable to genetic drifts and reduced fertility, which further accelerates their decline. So, what finally caused the demise of Neanderthals? This extinction, which occurred around 40,000 years ago, resulted from a complex interplay of factors rather than a single cause. A significant factor was climate change. During the late Pleistocene epoch, dramatic environmental changes such as cooler, more arid conditions reduced the availability of resources, challenging Neanderthals' ability to sustain their populations. Add on the competition for resources against Homo sapiens, who migrated into Europe and Asia, advanced tools and more efficient hunting strategies gave early humans an edge in securing food and other resources. Competitive disadvantages, paired with increasing pressure from environmental changes, likely contributed to the Neanderthals' ultimate decline. Novel diseases brought by humans into regions where Neanderthals lived had an even more devastating impact. The lack of immunity to new diseases resulted in higher mortality rates, further reducing numbers in population, making it harder for Neanderthals to recover. Small, isolated populations suffering from a reduced genetic diversity due to inbreeding, leading to decreased fertility and increased susceptibility to disease. The lack of genetic variation made them more vulnerable to extinction and diminished their ability to adapt to environmental and ecological changes. Each of these factors interplayed to create a challenging environment that Neanderthals finally just couldn't overcome, ending their time on Earth. If you found this video on the demise of Neanderthals fascinating, visit our channel for more interesting videos about the lives of prehistoric humans.